July podcast. The number one show to bring you all things Club America in English. From tactical analysis
pelota para la banda izquierda
to player updates. We've got you covered on all the latest news on Las Águilas. Now, let's start the show. This is the Eagle Eye Podcast.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to another episode of the Eagle Eye Podcast. Today, we're going to be breaking down that 5-1 stomping over Toluca. We're going to look ahead up to the Clásico Capitalino as well. And then, of course, we're going to be looking into everything in between Las Águilas del América. Of course, lots of news to talk about. CONCACAF Champions Cup, we're into the semifinals. Maybe we'll recap a little bit of that. Of course, we'll go into more depth of that next week when we preview the semifinal against Pachuca. Just plenty and plenty of Club America news to talk about in regards to that. And joining me today to do so, it is none other than New York's favorite resident, Christian Rosendo, and my backdoor neighbor, Chris Rivera. Gentlemen, how are we doing this fine evening?
Doing pretty good. I hope everyone's doing well. Finally got some good weather here in New York. So hopefully it continues, but doesn't look that over the next couple of days. Very excited to talk about this one. I think we just come off two amazing wins, I think that we're treading in the right direction, and I hope that everyone feels the same way. Everyone is joining the team right now, but it seems like there's someone that, you know, thinks that we're not doing things right, but I guess we'll get into that a little bit later.
Absolutely. Chris, how's life in sunny Orange County?
Very good, because the Lakers just won, so we're on to the playoffs, so...
There you go.
I know Lakers. It's an LA team, but we're all Laker fans for the most part in Southern California. So.
Well, the Lakers doing their best impression of being León and getting themselves into with the play-in.
Why León? Why are we picking on
Why León?
Was it a León who got... wait.
Daddy's not going to like that one.
Who got into the play-in last time?
A bunch of teams.
Right, but the one that actually won, was it San Luis? Yeah, it was San Luis, right?
Okay, because we faced San Luis, right? That was our first playoff game.
No. San Luis was the semis, no?
Oh, second, yeah. So who the hell was it? Maybe it was León. Yeah, it was León, because we faced León. I don't know, exactly. Bro. I remember. So maybe it is. I was like, what are we dissing León for?
I'm telling you. But, of course, excited to see. Hopefully the Lakers can make a deep run. I don't know how deep that run is going to be. But then again, people don't come into the EY podcast to listen to our basketball takes, because we probably would get them completely wrong. Gentlemen, glad to talk all things Club America, now shifting focus onto what an actual league leader looks like. Impressive week, like you mentioned, Christian, right? You talk about the CONCACAF Champions Cup. I know we'll dive into it a lot more into detail next week when we preview the Pachuca game, but just kind of give me what resonated with you in that game. Because we talked about the importance of getting the victory, right? Not necessarily getting a 5-2, because I don't think any of us predicted that performance or even that scoreline. But talk to me about the importance of what that game was and what resonated and kind of your takeaway quickly from the game against New England.
I think it just solidifies our position as being the number one team in the league. I think that everyone was kind of worried about how Toluca was playing, how we were going to react to that. It's a big game. We're fighting for first place. And we just went in there and completely just, I guess, dismantled everyone's opinion of what they had about us and what they had about Toluca. I think that we were kind of neck and neck. I think that we just proved that we're just maybe two or three steps ahead of them. And if we were able to do that to Toluca, then everyone else that comes after, it just seems like we're just on another level right now. It stems from coaching to everyone's individual forms right now, and just the cohesiveness of this team. It seems like we're hitting strides on all fronts, and it's a beautiful thing to watch. One thing I would like to mention, we'll talk about a little bit more maybe with Chris. I think you might find this interesting, how we kind of played Sendejas on the left, knowing that we have Brian there if he didn't want to risk Yunus, you know. I think it's interesting to see Sendejas play on the left rather than maybe Brian Rodriguez. But like I said, the you put position there, position change there. You know, Igor got hurt. Dramon came in. It was kind of like the same thing. It seems like everyone knows what they're doing. Everyone knows when to fill in. And we're just playing at an all-time high right now. And I hope it just continues into Liguilla.
Absolutely. You kind of jumped the gun because I was asking you about New England.
Oh, you were talking about New England.
Because I was like, wait. I was like, you completely went into the Toluca topic. But no, I mean, it's a great way to kind of talk about that game exactly.
That was just like, I mean.
No, but I was talking about the importance. Yeah, no, but I was talking about
the B team of New England. I mean.
Yeah, I mean, it was kind of written on the walls when the starting 11s came out. But I just wanted to hear your thoughts on the importance of getting the victory, kind of closing out the series on a high, right? I mean. I would imagine that then translates into something come Saturday.
I guess just in terms of confidence, yes, for sure.
Okay. All right. Chris, you're kind of 2 cents on this?
Well, I feel like we needed to score a lot. I think we were talking about Pachuca potentially tying or even losing, but going through, you know, like we needed all those goals just to just – have those goals in case we get home field advantage. We didn't get it, but either way, it's something that the fan base is always asking the team to do. It's really destroy these teams that we need to be destroying. No disrespect to New England, but we saw it in the first leg, and we knew that going into Mexico City, high altitude, they didn't necessarily come a day early or anything. You know, it was just a normal game for them. And they weren't going to shock us. And so if a team is already has that mindset, I think you need to just do what you did, right, and completely beat them. Now, like I said, we didn't get the home field advantage against Pachuca, but you do put yourself in a very good position against them, where if you do beat them, the final could very well be in the Estadio Azteca.
Yeah, and we'll get to the nitty-gritty of it all next week when we preview Pachuca. Maybe we'll kind of lay the groundwork as to what America needs to do in order to host that final, because it's not necessarily going to depend on them solely. A couple results have to go their way in order to secure that position. But goal differential-wise, they've already done a very good job at it. And so the week starts off with that New England Revolution victory. Then we kind of have to shift focus quickly and play a game in where I thought this one might definitely be our biggest challenge in the league coming into this one, right? Obviously, at the end of the game, completely different story. But you knew that there was more than just 3 points on the line. You knew that there's kind of this sense of, okay, this is our biggest test and probably the first big test throughout the season to see, okay, do we have the depth? Do we have the talent to go in and compete against the actual title contenders that are right behind us, which are your Monterreys and your Tolucas? And so this was interesting. And it got even more interesting a couple hours before kickoff, gentlemen, because Toluca decided that they were going to be spicy on the timeline and posted a very AI-generated picture of Toluca players laughing at an America player sitting on a bench, not on a bench, excuse me, on a chair, holding his head and saying, "We are your headache," right? Loosely translation, but I think it said somos tu dolor de cabeza or something like that in the image. And and then they decided to caption it with "guess who's back." When you guys see that, because I saw that actually late, I saw that maybe like a couple minutes before the game started. Mm-hmm. But when you see that, does that add just a little bit more to this game than what already was on the line?
I think it just makes it a little bit spicier. I honestly thought it was actually pretty creative the way they kind of did it. You know, so I will give them props for that. But yeah, I think it just adds to what everyone was leading up to this game. It was first versus second, battle for first. Literally, the winner of this pretty much paves their own path with being the first seed for the playoffs. So it was definitely an interesting touch by them.
Chris, what was your take on their little spicy tweet?
I liked it because if you really think about it, that's an old rivalry from the 2000s. So for me, it was just kind of like, you know, getting, just hyping their fan base up and and hyping us up too, because everyone had that bookmark, like, all right, we're
gonna see after 100%. The game. Yeah.
Everyone had it bookmarked, like, we're gonna see, you know, and it just reminded me, like, I see people talking in the comments, and they're all saying, like, you know, if Toluca was still an active competitive team, right, that was winning titles, or even a bigger fan base, we'd probably be viewing them as our number one rival, right? Which is very debatable, because I think you're always going to look at Chivas for what Chivas is, regardless of what their history or recent history is. But I do think that if Toluca is, like, right there, for the longest time, they were, like, they were a headache, right? Like, they were super annoying to face, even from the team arriving at their stadium, annoying, you know, like, they were very, like, loud, and it's not the same as it was when we were growing up, but still, it's cool to see that they want to hype something with us, because I don't think they'd do it to Cruz Azul or to a Chivas or a Pumas. I think for them, we're their biggest rivals, even if we don't view it like that, you know?
I think it just goes to a testament of what America is, and the greatness and kind of the imposing figure that we are, that we have a Toluca kind of knocking on our door and be like, hey, we want to be your, like, toe-to-toe rival. And I was like, all right, simmer down a little bit, right? Just calm down. So I thought it was an interesting touch. It definitely gets doesn't get the blood boiling, but it does kind of give you, like, okay, this is okay. Let's see then, you know, let's put it out on the pitch. I will say this though, I still absolutely hate going to El Estadio Nemesio Díaz on Sunday at noon, high noon, peak of the sun. We always struggle there, and we saw that last season too, right? America. I mean, it was up to debate as to whether or not we could have won that game. We actually lost Diego Valdez for the remainder of the season, right? He didn't come back until the Liguilla. It was an interesting kind of little way to kind of rile up the fans on both ends, because I think they knew exactly what they were coming for, right? And they were like, all right, we're going to put this out here. It's either going to work in our favor, or it's going to go completely against us. And it was definitely the latter. So let's talk exactly what happened to this Toluca side that actually went sideways. And what did America do so well? I have to applaud Jardine here. I think Sendejas on the left-hand side was the right call to make. And look, I am a Brian Rodriguez fan. Like, I've been rooting for him since day one. I just feel like Sendejas offers a little bit something more when he plays with Diego Valdez, when he plays with Henry, when he plays with Fidalgo. He has an understanding that I think Brian doesn't really necessarily have just yet, or maybe because he's coming off the bench so much. But I think I like Sendejas on that left-hand side. If you guys notice, he plays a lot with Fidalgo, and there's a lot of interchanging in positions. And I noticed that a lot, specifically in the game against Cruz Azul at Dignity Health Sports Park. I was like, okay, something works here specifically. And I think that's why Jardine opted for that. But other things that I can think of from the top of my head, excuse me, is the fact that we came at them and took the game right away. Like, we took them from the get-go. We took the game to them, kind of put them on their toes. And we were playing very aggressive and very fast-paced. And I think it definitely paid off to our benefits. But I want to hear from you guys. What did you guys see in the opening minutes that you were like, okay, this is a game that's definitely going our way?
Yeah, just like you said, I think that we had a clear picture in mind, is take the game to them. Let us set the tempo. Let them play into our game. And it's funny you mentioned the Diego Valdez comment, because that's exactly the player I wanted to talk about today. And it seems like we're getting his best version back. I think this is probably his best game of the whole season. He was just lights out, making a perfect pass every single time, the perfect runs, perfect decision making, and he could have had a hat trick if it weren't for that miss in that second half. And honestly, he deserved it, because he played lights out. And if this is the Valdez we're going to get for the rest of the season, then, boy, everyone's in for a lot of trouble. Because when this man is playing, the team just rises up to a whole different level. And when we're already three steps ahead of everyone, now you have an informed Diego Valdez, then it's like I don't mean to sound so conceited and so, like, annoying, but, like, who really can beat us when we have our number 10 playing like that. And it showed right here. We dismantled the number one team in the league. And it seemed like before they scored their second goal, I mean their first goal, it didn't seem like they were even in the game. And it's just unbelievable to see how well we play when Diego Valdez is in form.
And I would credit that goal that they scored to us. That was 100% a mistake on our end, Chris. I think you see there's a miscommunication. First, I think Jonah doesn't contest the ball, which I think is very poor of him. Then Cáceres bites a little bit too early and gets beaten there. Igor doesn't even make an attempt to try to, you know, go for the man. So he's just, the Toluca player just runs in. And I would even say Malagón dives a little too early, kind of gives it away, the side where the ball goes in. So really a mistake completely on our end. But the response you get from América right after, I mean, talk to me about that.
That's what I loved about the whole thing, right? Because I felt like when they scored, I kind of felt like, oh, it's going to be one of those games, right? I don't know if you guys felt the same way, but it just felt like one of those errors that you don't normally see us do, but when we do make them, the game could be very ugly. And just the fact that we were able to just respond quick and really take control, like you guys said, a very aggressive America that I feel we don't see as much as we should. I feel like sometimes we end up playing with the ball a little bit too much. And this time it just felt like we were on a mission to really prove that, hey, we might be tied in points, but we're not the same teams. You know, there's still this gap that you're not going to see on the table, but you're going to see it on the field. And I was very happy to see us really play aggressive, play smart, and also just, you know, like not care that you got scored on, you made a mistake. There's some teams that simply make a mistake and they just kind of lose themselves, right? They get shocked that they made that mistake. And it's good that you show signs like this, because in Liguilla, those mistakes could happen. We see them a lot throughout our recent history, but even other teams where they make a mistake and they're lost completely and they think it's over. But if you're able to react this way, you know, you really can bounce back from whatever mistake you made.
I mean, is there any more to add to that, Christian?
No, I mean he hit everything on the spot there. It's just, you look at this team and then you're trying to pinpoint, like, if you're to look, you look at this team like, where can I hit them from? Where can I hit them from? And it's like, okay, maybe I can hit them from like a set piece kind of thing. Okay, you get by them, but then you have to get through, you know, our talented goalie that seems to be just stopping and saving everything, right? And then it's just so hard to compete against a team like that when they kind of almost have an answer for everything. But I do like that once a mistake is made, the team knew how to respond, especially in a game like this where it could have gone away from us very quickly, right? They could have easily grew from that. They could have got instant momentum, taking it through the rest of the first half. Who knows, maybe they could have gotten the lead. But I think that 1 minute response, if it even was a minute, response by Henry Martin, and you know, I think that kind of just killed them. I think they were like, well, we kind of wasted, you know, we got lucky in our goal, and then let's see if we can kind of maybe keep the result, maybe sneak a sneaky one here. But now the fact that they had a score again, it was just like, it seemed like a tall task to do, especially when throughout the whole game Malagón kept just knocking everything out of the goal. So, you know, great overall performance from the team. And like everyone said, we just need this to keep to continue into these last couple of games.
Yeah, there's two things that I want to quickly just kind of glance over, because I think it's important. The second one is going to be the Malagón thing, because I think he has just been phenomenal. I mean, you saw the highlights. Two, three phenomenal saves, actually, that game. But the first thing I want to talk about is, like you guys mentioned, there's this sense of that America has an answer to everything, right? And most importantly, when going forward, I've criticized this team a lot throughout this season that we haven't found the consistency in front of goal. We create chances, but we aren't really putting them away, right? It seems to be that's not the case. I mean, for the past 2 weeks, America has been scoring goals left, right, and center, right? Sure, most of those were against New England Revolution, but look, you still have to go out there. You still have to play these games. You still have to score those goals. And I think that this is the perfect moment for America to start finding that consistency and start finding that form. Because if you're scoring goals, if you're scoring five past Toluca, who is second place or who was first place in the league, that should instill some confidence that you can go in and you could score another four, another five against this Pachuca side in the CONCACAF semifinals, right? Who's to say that you can't go into Liguilla and blow the competition out of the water like you did last season? So again, it was some heavy criticism, and I think it was fair criticism because I think we were so used to an America side that was so dominant and so goal-scoring last season that this season when we were creating the chances but we weren't putting them away, that I felt like, okay, something's missing here. But now, it seems to be that everyone's firing on all cylinders, right? You're seeing Diego Valdez, like you mentioned, Christian, finding the form. And when he's scoring and when he's assisting, things happen for this team. Henry Martin.
Just having fun out there, and that's scary
exactly.
For the rival team.
Exactly. Henry Martin, one goal shy away from 100, has already made history for America, tying Chava Cabañas, passing Chava Cabañas, tying Carlos Reynoso, potentially getting to that 100 goal mark, hopefully very soon. I feel like when those two players are scoring goals and assisting and making things happen, this team has a full different dynamic, a whole different attitude, and it feels just a lot different. Like everyone else plays off their, not necessarily plays off their vibe, but when you can play off of Henry Martin and play off of Diego Valdez and they're opening channels and they're making assists and they're scoring goals, you're thinking to yourself, well, piece of cake.
Right. Yeah?
So
I don't know if you guys agree with me, but like I don't know if we've seen Henry Martin's best form yet. I think he's just starting to get there.
Yeah, I think he's picking it up. I think he's, you know, I think it starts off with Diego Valdez and it kind of trickles down, right? Mm-hmm. Because you're starting to see a better Henry. You're going to most likely see a better Quiñones, right? He scored two goals. Mind you, they're tapping, so I'm not really too crazy about him. But he's coming into form of scoring, right? And I think players like that need goals in order to come to life, right? Sendejas is a player that probably had picked up form way before Diego Valdez. But, you know, it kind of gets a domino effect going, Chris, that, okay, one player hits, then the other player, then you just kind of keep the ball rolling, and now you have a full starting 11. Like Christian mentioned, you just don't really know where to attack it from to give it a weakness.
Yeah, and then you look at the bench, and is there even a weakness in the bench? Maybe Nestor Araujo, but even then, like even when he's playing, he doesn't look awful. Mind you, it's time for him to go. I'm not here to defend Nestor Araujo, but my thing is, like, our only weakness this whole season has been Emilio Lara. Literally, has only been the only weakness we've had. And he's not even, now that everyone's healthy, he's not even an option, you know? Like,
yeah.
Thank God we found Israel Reyes as a right back. Well, there's one thing I kind of want to touch on, Henry Martin. Someone on Twitter posted in the 21st century, Henry Martin's third in assists. So Sambuesa's first with 47, Montenegro's second with 45, and Henry Martin's third with 44, wow. Which is crazy. You know, if you really think about it, because he's a striker for starters, mm-hmm. And he didn't get consistent playing time early on like those other two. So it's crazy to me that he's third. You know.
Christian, for me, the more crazier thing is Montenegro's all the way up there.
How much is that Chucho Benitez, though? How much is that
and Cabañas. Benitez
carrying? And Cabañas, yeah.
No, but I think it just feeds into what you're saying, Ivan, that when people can play off Henry Martin, it's just a beautiful thing to watch them because he's just making everyone else around him a little bit better.
Yeah, it's funny because, like Chris mentions, like this is not a player that got regular minutes. Like this is a player that struggled to get minutes. Like he has now been a consistent starter or a consistent goal scorer for America for the what? It only started happening for the past 3-4 years ago. Like that's when he started being more consistent. Like beforehand, he was seen the bench. He was on and off, injuries.
Could have been a starter early on, though.
But
we know that. I think it's crazy. You bring in Nico Castillo and you bring in Roger Martinez, and you pay that amount, he's never going to get that.
Yeah, he's never going to see the light of day.
Just politics when it comes to football, right? You're not going to give a player that you waste, that was a loan player, right? He came in as a loan player, and you brought Nico and you bought Roger for, I don't even remember the fee, but I remember it was a crazy amount of money that, you know, so.
Yeah, that was
money wasted. There's a reason why it took this long, but.
Yeah, but look, at the end of the day, still, like, it's impressive. And someone, I don't know who tweeted it out, but someone said, I think Henry Martinez. Oh, I think Layun tweeted it out that Henry Martin should be considered a legend for Club America. And I don't necessarily think he's too wrong. I mean, if in a hypothetical world, if Henry Martin is our captain and we win the 15th and we win the CONCACAF Champions Cup, mind you, we won the prior cup and we go on and we potentially win Campeones Cup. Like, I think at that point, you start giving him more than just his flowers. I think you start making that conversation like, okay, this guy should definitely be considered someone important for the club, right? So,
100%.
Yeah, I think there's some merit here. Absolutely. And look, the whole Henry Martin story is a crazy one. And then one day it will be told in its full story, right? From a player that could have potentially gone to Chivas, you know? and the crazy thing happens is really we have to thank Piojo for the fact that, you know, he kind of convinces Henry to come over here. Actually, we have to thank an injury that Henry picks up right before he signs with Chivas. So it's a crazy story. It's a crazy kind of world where things unfold. But at the end of the day, we're lucky to have Henry. And yeah, I mean, if he goes out and nets that 100 goal, like Kevin Perez saying, he's going to net it against... hold on, Chris. I don't know what I did right there. I made you super tiny. He nets it against
Cruz Azul. I was going to say, damn, bro.
And he nets it against Pumas. And correct me if I'm wrong. I'm pretty sure he's done the celebration, right? The Germán Villa celebration?
Yes.
So I'm curious to see what... Henry's kind of known for these celebrations, so I'm curious. He has something for the 100. He's got something up his sleeve. But yeah, great job by Henry. And when we're talking about players and kind of deserving their merits, Christian, you talked about it, right? Another great form factor of America is knowing that you're well secured at the back. And I will say this, I think as much as we praise all the other players, the most consistent player we've had, and I will argue probably the best player of the season so far, has been Malagón. I don't think anyone could debate against that, right? So for me, I mean, against Luca, again, shows out, does a great job. I mean, what more could you say about this, Chris?
I mean, I want to know your thoughts. Is his season good enough to bench Ochoa? That's what I want to know, because everyone already has thrown Ochoa, but I want someone that's a pro Ochoa, because let's be honest, when you bring up the Ochoa conversation, everyone has a bias to him. No one's really having a serious conversation to it. Someone wants a younger keeper. Some people don't want Ochoa because Teresa. Some people don't want Ochoa because Chicharito brought in women, whatever the hell is going on with all that, you know. But my point is, like everyone has a reason to love them or a reason to hate them, and no one's just in the middle to say, this is his performance, this is their performance, this is why this guy's better, this is why he's better. So I want to hear it from you. And I know people are going to be like, well, why are you asking a pro Ochoa? But either way, I want to hear from you. Is it enough to bench Ochoa and put Malagón as the starter for Copa America and after?
Objectively speaking, yes. Only because Ochoa isn't playing regularly right now with Salernitana. They're already relegated. They have already said that they're giving the other goalkeeper more minutes. I mean, Ochoa already broke contract basically with Salernitana. He had another year. They said, okay, look, you're free to go. I think he's in right now, he's in the middle of negotiating contracts with his next club. What that next club is going to be, I have no idea. Is it going to be San Diego? Maybe. I highly doubt it, though. I think he wants to, he wants that World Cup. And I don't necessarily think that he wants to come and settle for the MLS just yet. So we'll see if maybe there's another European team that he can kind of go in there, have a good season, get some minutes. But the more he's not playing, the more he's riding the bench, the more that these performances that Malagón gives, the higher up the pecking order he's going. And so at the moment right now, like I said, objectively speaking, look, I can hit it from all different angles and I can debate why Ochoa should still be the national team goalkeeper. But for sake and purposes to keep it short, yeah, I think Malagón has done enough to merit the start. So.
All right, so second question. Is Tapia should be the second? No, I'm just kidding.
It's a long goalkeeper conversation that I would love to have, but we'll just move on from there. But I mean, anything else to add on to this, Christian?
I just think that it was a complete game from the team. Definitely going to give us confidence heading into the Clásico this Saturday. And then fourth, our semifinal tie against Pachuca, because now we're getting into the real business, right? This is it. So on Tuesday night, right?
Next Tuesday night, yes.
Next Tuesday night is when we'll really see our likely chances of going to that Club World Cup, which I think the institution really wants. The players want it. You hear them talking about it all the time in post game interviews. They have their mind straight set on it, and it's go time.
Definitely. And we'll get you guys up to date with everything going on next week. Make sure you guys tune in. Monday should be a fun one. We'll get you guys covered with all things Club America ahead of this Pachuca matchup. But yeah, like you mentioned, very good, well-rounded, and we'll talk about Pumas in a bit, shortly. But yeah, I don't think anything else to add on to this one. Like you said, well-rounded, well done. The only nitpick I have for this game, Chris, is America's response to Toluca on Twitter was very soft. It just wasn't good. Like, I was expecting more.
Bro, I wanted them to do what The Rock was doing in WWE, bro. If you pay attention to all that. It's PG, but not for us.
It's unfortunate. I mean, it's unfortunate. I was expecting more from the content manager, because he did an amazing job against Chivas, you know? And so I was expecting him to be a little spicy on the timeline too, but I mean, I guess that's what we're here for. So we'll leave it at that. But okay, gentlemen, we kind of switch the page, forget about Toluca, and then we start moving forward to Pumas. But before, let's talk a little about some club news briefly, right? Because I think the last topic we have is going to take up more time. But briefly, Gibran and I had talked about potential substitutions for Fidalgo, right? He talked about Fidel Ambriz, Guido Rodriguez, and Luis Chavez.
And another one that he didn't know the name of, but that he's in Mexico.
I don't know what happened with my camera. Just forget it. Just keep going. Just keep rolling. But talk to me. Do you guys like it or not? This whole talk about these replacements, because I don't think it's the time or place yet to do so. Like, yes, we could talk about rumors, but I don't know. I'm not buying on all of this just yet. I feel like, yeah, it's nice to have, but they're not also names that fill me with a lot of confidence.
So I'll say this much. I think any of the names that were mentioned don't fill what Fidalgo brings to the team. I think that individually they're good players that maybe could serve a different purpose. But if we're trying to bring in someone to kind of replace Fidalgo and kind of do what he did, maybe a little bit better, then these players are not it. I think maybe these are more replacements for maybe Dos Santos in a sense, maybe like a partner to Fidalgo. But in terms of, because I think that's what the whole topic is about, right? Because Fidalgo's going to leave, this and that. We need someone to come in. I don't think it's any of these players.
No, I don't think so either. Chris?
For me, I believe that this is a legit shortlist. I have mixed feelings for every single one. I'm not a fan of Luis Chavez. I watch him play, and it's just kickball. I'm not a fan of that. It's just nothing of his game other than free kicks and shooting from distance is like stands out to me. Right. But he's just too much of a gamble for me. It's a player you bring in with Fidalgo on the team, not necessarily as a replacement. And Guido Rodriguez, to me, it's more like Christian said. Yes, it's for Jonathan Dos Santos. For me, all these players are like, all right, Richard Sanchez is the guy that has to leave. We all agree that they're upgrades, right? Like even though some people may argue that Richard Sanchez is literally Luis Chavez, pretty much, you know, similar player. Even then, like, I view Luis Chavez as an upgrade over Richard Sanchez. I mean, I told you guys last week how I feel about Richard Sanchez, and it's just becoming one of these things where I think something new there would just be a fresh air, you know? And I don't know who that fourth guy is. That's where I guess we kind of assume who it is. Because they said, if someone said the league, I would assume it's Tito Sanchez. And if the price tag is $12 million, that's like they were trying to push that he's the best player in the league. I'm sorry, but he's cool. But
if the price tag is not $2 million,
that cool, in my opinion, you know, like I don't think he's that great.
Yeah, no, like it's like we mentioned, there's not names that fill you with a lot of confidence. It's funny. I don't know if you guys already follow the Club America Reddit community. If you guys don't follow them, it's great. Some great conversations over there. Someone was talking about exactly what we were mentioning, right? And I kind of commented and saying, I don't think necessarily there's anybody right now that is going to come in and fill Fidalgo's shoes from the get-go. I think it's going to have to be a quote-unquote project. He's going to have to build up to it. No one's going to come in and give you the same results as Fidalgo. Like, unless you're going to buy Kevin De Bruyne, I don't think anyone comes in here and absolutely just does what Fidalgo does. Like, it's going to be a new... We're going to have to fill...
You want me to name someone that might...
Go for it.
And I'm my bad for interrupting, but I want to see your reaction, because right away when you said there's no one, I right away thought about the guy that Fidalgo replaced. You know who I'm talking about? I think, what about Cordoba?
Uribe?
Do you see a... No, not Uribe. Cordoba.
Oh. No. No,
you
no.
You think so?
No. You're asking me. The guy who had like a vendetta against Cordoba.
I'm asking both of you because you're both saying no. Like, I want to see your reaction because I think he might bring not necessarily the same thing, but similar playing style, contributes very similar to the game. Mexican,
like. Similarly, yeah, but I feel like Cordoba is more attached to maybe a wing in a sense and kind of drifts to the middle. I kind of view him like that more.
I disagree with that because I think he's awful anytime he plays on the wing or moves to the wing.
So I think he's just awful in general. I don't think he fits in the Samarica side.
Yeah, no.
There's a reason he's making it in Tigres and he's not making it here. Like, you know, I get it. There could be, he could have matured, he could have grown, he could have learned. But does he fit Jardine's system? And does he do what Fidalgo's going to do? No. You need, like I said, you need someone that can go in there and play at the same tempo and play kind of the same style. And it's hard. Like, no one in the league, I think, can come in and do what Fidalgo does. I mean, no one comes close to his numbers, you know? And so I think America's going to have a hard time filling in those shoes. And because of that, I think maybe we have to find a different playing style in that midfield. But again, we'll see. Look, this is a conversation that we're going to have a lot of come summer, right? And so I didn't want to dwell too much into it, but I think it's just... It was interesting to note.
Isn't there a graphic Fidalgo, like, top 10 in the world for like the past month? That's been shared recently?
It's top 4 in contributing plays, I think.
Top 4 yeah, in the
midfield.
So,
Cordoba doing that, buddy.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Well, we'll see. Look, like I said, I just wanted to maybe kind of pick your guys' brains because obviously they were talking about this during the game And I'm sure they're going to talk about it again in the next game and the following game. It's because they always like to talk about that stuff. But we'll see. We'll see what happens. But all right, one last big bit of news for America in regards to us being in the news. And then we'll talk about Pumas. Again, my camera goes, don't worry about it, guys. I have no idea what's going on with my camera. But so we were on the... we played against New England. We got our ticket into the next round. Monterrey played against Miami. They beat Miami. And for some reason, Tata Martino decided that he wanted to throw some shade at America. Why? I'm not too sure. I want to pick you guys' brain out. But before we do so, I want us to listen to Tata Martino and listen to what he had to say. And then we'll talk in regards to what you guys think and how out of line he was. So here's Tata Martino and his words after the press conference.
Siempre me pareció cuando trabajaba en México y ahora que no trabajo en México, una comparación bastante inútil. Yo creo que lo que tienen que hacer las federaciones es mirar su estructura, ver cómo compiten, ver cómo es un torneo, ver si progresan, ver si no progresan, ver cuál es el aporte que hacen a selecciones nacionales. Porque, a ver, ¿qué, de poco importa? No es el caso de Rayados, porque Rayados tiene mucho aporte a la selección, pero que, ¿cuánto importa para la selección nacional que América salga campeón de este torneo y el aporte a selección no es tan importante? Porque las figuras más notorias son generalmente extranjeras.
All right, so there you guys have it. Tata Martino talking about Las Águilas del América and talking about how Monterrey exports more players to the Selección Mexicana, so that's why he shouldn't throw any shades at them. But what does it matter if América wins a CONCACAF Champions Cup, Christian, if the national team is not benefiting from this? How crazy of a statement is that, first of all?
I think that my man was just flustered that he couldn't beat Rayados with his all-star team. And basically what every Mexican, or I guess what every person that watches Liga MX and knows that Liga MX is just superior to MLS, well, we all knew that that Miami was going to have a difficult time when they came to Mexico. It's just that it's just the nature of just MLS teams. They just can't compete in Mexico. So for me, I think it was just him being salty, and trying to just trying to say whatever he can to kind of save face. But I mean, it simply had no correlation of whatever just happened like 20 minutes ago in his match. It just didn't make sense to me. Like I said, I just think he was just trying to just come up with anything to kind of get out of whatever the hell they were asking him.
Absolutely. Chris, America was kind of like that 50 Cent meme of like, what are you talking about me for? You like, you know?
Exactly. I find it hilarious because whoever follows me on Twitter, you guys know I'm a tuck my ish. Like, I don't care what people think. I'm going to try to hit you with facts. People always try to put Pachuca as the savior of Mexican football because they give Mexicans a chance. Meanwhile, there's only been like four Mexicans in the past 10, 15 years that they've sent to Europe, which is Herrera, Pisulto, Chucky, and Gutierrez, right? But they're the saviors, right? Meanwhile, I could go down the list of all the players we've sent. We've destroyed teams, right, for the national team. It's funny, and I don't want to rant. I know Dennis probably like, man, shut up. But I get annoyed. I get annoyed of this because me and Christian get into these conversations, into these debates about the national team and I'm more club and all this, right? And this is where I get very annoyed. The country is very anti-Americanistas, which I love. Hate me, right? We say that for a reason. Hate me because I honestly don't care if my team is successful and the reason you hate me is because my team is successful and I'm rubbing it in your face. Well, cool. You know, I'm cool with that. But I don't like that he pushes that narrative, right? And it's only to come out good with the rest of the country. That's all really what he's trying to do. I know a lot of people are saying, oh, his team lost. He doesn't make a comment like that if he cares if his team lost. He's going to sit here and say, oh, well, what does it matter if America wins if they don't do anything with the national team? he took more players from our academy and our team to the World Cup. So, you know, is he aware of that? You know, like, is he aware that we destroyed our national team for or our teams twice for the national team, right? In 2013, and with him, we sold Lainez when he wasn't ready. And Edson, we could have been difficult with Edson. We could have been like, hey, no, you don't go anywhere. We sent other youngsters who were like Naveda to Poland and other youngsters to Belgium and second divisions. And we could have been like, no, we're going to stay here and sell you cheap to a second division team. And so I get very annoyed hearing this because it's narratives that now every other person that hates on us is going to push. And the reality isn't that. And the numbers and everything, the facts are right in front of us. There's only one other team that competes with us when it comes to exporting to Europe, and it's probably Santos, right? Because either they sold it to us and we sent them, or they from them, whatever. But point is, like, these are narratives that I get very annoyed of, and he's only saying it for the simple fact that he knows the rest of Mexico is going to be like, oh, let's get behind them. We're not going to throw his way because even though we hate Tata, we hate America more. And this is where I get like I don't care if the national team does good or bad. This as long as America does good. That's all I care about. And this is where my feelings towards the national team comes from.
Yeah, I mean, where to start off, right? I mean, you can pick this from every direction, but I think it goes back to what I had just mentioned at the beginning of the podcast. It's just the power of America. If you're being honest, it's the power that America has. Because how do we get talked about and how do we get in a conversation between a match between Monterrey and Inter Miami where the narrative should be Messi and friends failing against Monterrey and the tabloids were running with, oh, America's not doing a good job to export to the Mexican national team per, you know, former national Mexican national team manager. That my thing is, okay, that's the power of America. That's the power that we have, that we can be in discussion even when we don't play. That's
Right.
crazy. That's power. That's greatness. On the other end, I'm not even going to debate the whole national team side because you guys both know where I stand on that, right? I am pro club over national team, right? America's first and the national team I think is like maybe 18th. From my perspective is one, why is he not trying to throw shade at Monterrey if he just lost against them and saying that they export more players to the national team when that's not even the case? I think we export more, or if not the same amount. Like, I think they export what, four, five if Moreno's healthy. First of all, I don't think Moreno should be called up, but again, I'm not going to get into that narrative. The other thing is, this is a club competition. This is not national teams going at each other. I even tweeted this out. That's like saying, what good is it for Real Madrid to win a Champions League this season if they only exported two players in the past call-up to them to the Spain national team? That's putting oranges and tuna trying to match those two things together. It's not gonna work. They're not in the same world. It's not the same atmosphere or stratosphere, whatever you want to call it. It's I have no other word to put it than but plain stupid. Like, honestly,
Salty. It's just
I
salty
mean,
because I think he's starting to realize that his project
we're
isn't
being
working.
scapegoated.
No, of course.
If you even want to call it that. But like I said, I just think he's just salty out of the whole thing. His project's not working. Messi and friends, the whole thing is just it's not gonna do well. Everyone's only getting older and we're only getting better. So if maybe he thought this was like his perfect opportunity to win the whole thing, but you know, it's I don't think he'll ever have another opportunity like this because, like I said, Mexican team or Liga MX teams, for what I see in the foreseeable future, we're just gonna be better, and we've proved it time and time again in this competition.
Absolutely,
You
absolutely.
want to
And you
know
know
the
what
funny thing about this whole thing?
what is it?
We're probably gonna say the same thing. The fact that they're most likely gonna be the host of the World Cup of Clubs because the MLS
exactly?
has a host spot
Why is he
and they're
being
gonna
salty if he
gift
knows
it to
he
them.
has that
And
entryway?
exactly,
Yeah,
and it's
because they haven't
super
even
annoying
said
that
who's gonna get it.
We all know they're gonna
We
make
know
some
who's gonna
dumb
get it.
rule.
Come on.
Yeah.
Come on. We all know. They're probably gonna do a whatever cup they have in MLS and they're gonna win it because it's more secure to win that cup than the league, and they're gonna give it to them. Come on, it's predictable. I don't care because I wanted to face them in the final. To me, like, maybe it's my Real Madrid side where I just think everything Barcelona's super phony, but like, I would have loved to beat them 7-0 on the Azteca and had Fidalgo squash Messi. I don't know, man.
I think we all knew that a potential America Miami final was going to get a lot of traction, not just from maybe the Americas, but from like maybe the whole world. So it would have been good exposure for us, kind of beating that team 7-0 in the final. That would have been fun to watch. Because if you really watch that second leg, and if the final was potentially going to be played, whether it be in California or Mexico, don't get it twisted, whether it was in California, U.S. or Mexico, I think we're going to have more fans. We were going to show the world, potentially, that America is just a superior team. And we have been cooking for the past 2 years. And that would have been the perfect showcase. So, you know, it sucks we're not going to do it against them. But maybe hopefully whoever we do go up against, that it'll still gain kind of, maybe not the same traction, but people will know about us and what we've been doing.
No, I agree. Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, I wanted to pick you guys' brain, and I'm glad I did. I think it was, some good stuff here. Some absolutely good stuff. And like, yeah,
you got me
it's
riled
unfortunate.
Up, brother, because I didn't see the whole video.
Well, there you go. Even better.
We got riled up with that video.
We got a more raw reaction there. But yeah, I mean, we'll see. I think there might be a near future where America could face off against Inter Miami in the League's Cup. And this could add a little bit more fuel to the flame. So we'll see we'll see if that ever does come to fruition. But again, it is what it is in that forefront. But yeah, all right, let's move from that. Let's talk Clásico Capitolino because we don't got much time here. Big game, actually huge game for America, if you guys thinking about it. If America does win,
or draw.
Obviously, or draw, we'll see. Wait, hold on, you didn't know where I was going with this. If America does win, then, you know, Jardine would continue his unbeaten stretch in the league in Clásicos. Now, Christian, if America does also win, it would secure 100% first place. But talk to me about the math, because I did not see a draw in my 148 times that I was doing the calculations.
Oh, I only said draw because that's what they said in the broadcast last week.
Oh, my God. You didn't even do the math. Let me see. Let me do the math real quickly. Because we sit at 32, Toluca sit at 29 with Monterrey and Cruz Azul. If we get a draw, that puts us at 33. Now, we would still need to win the second game against Puebla. But if you win against Pumas, then you automatically secure first place.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
So, again, huge game on the line. More so because it's a Clásico, but also because you get to secure first place, and then you don't necessarily have to think about that Puebla game. Not to say that it's a throwaway game, but knowing that you have Pachuca, knowing that you have this CONCACAF semifinal, knowing that you have to go strong in these two games, if you can secure first place already, might as well do so, no?
Yes, 1,000%. I think that should be the clear mentality going into Saturday. Just the win, nothing less. It'll relieve a lot of pressure heading into that second leg because we are going to play it away.
It's going to be crucial. Chris, talk to me about what America needs to do to get those 3 points.
You have to treat it as a Clásico, right? This is a Clásico. This is the second most important rivalry in our history. This is the Academy Clásico. They hate us and we hate them. This is the in-city Clásico. Hey, you guys heard me before how I view Cruz Azul. It's complete opposite of what I view Pumas. This is a team that hates us. Every other team hates us, but this team, like, hates us like that neighbor that never shuts up and has that music loud on the weekdays. Like, that type
yeah.
of hatred. Like, it's deep. And I know Jardiner probably looks at it like, okay, like, we need to win this. Jardine has treated other Clásicos the same way, with the mentality of destroying them and exposing them, and I think that's exactly what he's going to do. I think we're going to see a very similar side to what we saw with Toluca, and I think Pumas is going to come in way more aggressive than Toluca. It's going to be a very, very, very entertaining game, in my opinion.
Christian's talking to me about specifically that starting 11 that we could potentially see. Do you think it's a rinse and repeat of the game against Toluca, or do we potentially see a Quiñones start?
I do think we see Quiñones start, so I think the only change from that 11 would be Di Rosan out, put Sendejas back on the right wing, and then put Julian on the left wing. I think this serves as a perfect game kind of for everyone to kind of get back together, playing together before the semifinal game. It's going to be an interesting one, not only because of it's a Clásico, but Pumas has a lot riding on this game also. They're currently in a play-in position with like two teams breathing down their necks. So they're going to have to get or gun for a lot of points or the max points that they can in the next two games. So they're not going to go easy. It's not going to be an easy game because they have a lot at stake here also. Yeah, it's a gauntlet down there. Any result that happens from all of these games can affect everyone. So it should be very interesting how they come out. And hopefully we're able to impose our game plan early on and kind of set the tempo to kind of make sure they feed into what we're trying to play. And, you know, we obviously get our objective, which is the win in first place for the entirety of Liguilla.
I agree. So then the question stands, gentlemen. Who comes out guns blazing? Do we see Pumas try to take the game to us early and try to disrupt us, or do we see a repeat of what America did to Toluca and, you know, kind of just take the game to them from the get-go? Where do you see kind of the balance of this game go?
I think they're going to come at us. I think they have to come at us. I think they're going to try to do what other teams don't do as much, which has come to us. I think, like I said, it's a Clásico. It's a team that is going to go in there and hit, whether physically or shots or whatever. You know, it's just going to be a very aggressive team. I think they kind of have to, based on where their season is going. I think they can't necessarily lose, right? Because if they lose, you got other teams coming up, pushing them out the way. And for them, this is their end of the season, per se. If they win, it continues. If they lose, it might be over. And I think America needs to really be planted good. I think that's the most important thing, is being planted perfectly and being ready for anything they throw at us and be able to give it back to them when we have the ball on our feet.
Christian, if that's the case, I'm liking it, because use and abuse that speed all day long on the counter.
That's what I'm saying, yeah. I think we're a very good transition team. I think we saw that against the Luka, that we can attack the spaces very well. We have the players to do so, even players on the bench that just understand perfectly how to play against a team like this. So everything looks favorable for us. I think that, like, obviously, we're the better team. We know what we want, and it's just a matter of implementing that game plan on the pitch. And also, like something you alluded to earlier, you know, we got to be clinical, right? The chances that we get, let's try to make the most out of it, because you know, we're still on the road. You know, we're still at a small disadvantage just being on the road. So you know, and anything that we have, let's try to make the most of it and kind of just put the game, not necessarily to bed early, but make sure that they're uncomfortable for a majority of the game.
I would definitely hope that that is the case for America. Like we said, there's a lot riding on here, and I would say that I think the players know what's at stake as well, more than just this 3 points and the Clásico. I think this is a well-balanced side, and I think Jardinet has a good idea of how he wants to plant this team. Obviously, the objective is CONCACAF Champions Cup, so that's why I think he will go as strong as he can for this one, and then kind of like quick turnaround, do it again on Tuesday, and then don't even worry about Friday's game if you win against Pumas, and then do it all over again the following Tuesday. So, I just want to see a good America side, basically just echo the same thing that you saw against Luka, that you saw against New England, right? In these good games, and where, like you mentioned, Christian, that transition play is fluid. And in moments, I think, where America knows when they need to have the ball, when to dominate with the ball possession. It's funny because I think the team understands how to read the moment and how to read the game perfectly. And there's moments in the match where they're doing 1-2 passes and they're like 2 feet away from each other. But it's so smart because what they're doing is they're inviting the other team to kind of pull forward, and then they'll play a 1-2 pass and boom, they've broken the line. Right? And they understood that, okay, in that moment, you play a little bit, you kind of get under their skin, and then you find a way around that low block. So again, it's a very impressive America side that I hope can have a very impressive game against Pumas and continue that consistency. Because, Chris, the one thing America needs to do is continue to find a form, because we know how important kind of having form and closing off the season in a good stretch of form is for the Liga.
And the important thing from all of this too is the fact that we get into Liguilla, there's going to be that bye week, but we play Pachuca's second leg in that bye week, right? So you kind of keep momentum. You don't have to go and play against a youth squad. You don't have to go and play against a second division team or even rest them for a week without doing anything. I hope there's not a national team game within that, because that didn't happen last season, right?
No, there isn't.
2 weeks off. Yeah, so even better, right? So America keeps momentum. It doesn't even matter, like, you know, it matters, but it doesn't matter that we face that Pachuca in that second leg. And like I told you in the group chat, Ivan, there's a good chance Pachuca has a game within 2 weeks, or in 2 days, right? If they don't make Liguilla and they end up going to the play-in, they have to kind of really not force things, but really choose what's more important, whether it's CONCACAF or league. And it could really mess up their plans, right? So for us, this win against Pumas is really important. Like I said, rivalry, it's a clásico, our second most important clásico. If you ask the academy players, they'll say it's their main clásico. But regardless, you have to win. You secure that first place spot. And I think you have two more games or one more game after that, and you could really rest and plan for that CONCACAF game.
Absolutely, absolutely. All right, gentlemen, prediction time. What are you guys going with? Christian, Saturday's game at Seoul, what's your prediction?
I think that we will win the game 2-0.
2-0. I'm loving this clean sheet. I'm loving it. I was very, very upset when we got scored on against Toluca. Not because of how we got scored on, but because we let a goal in, and I was like, man, this is frustrating, but I'd love
should
a clean sheet.
Should have been 6-1, by the way. I don't think we touched on that, right? That Brian O'Dittles was.
Yeah, no. Point. Yeah, but okay. At that point, they were already dead in the water. Chris. I know. But prediction, Chris.
Be ready to be upset, brother. Be ready to be upset, because I got 3-1.
Okay, it's fine. Look, I'm okay, because that first place is more important than a clean sheet, but I'm not going to lie. I'm probably going to be a little bit upset on the day of. But hey, 3-1, I'm taking it. That's another 2-goal differential right there. I'm gonna go against all of you guys like I usually do in these predictions. I'm going 1-0 for America. I know it's maybe not the most trendiest thing, and I probably is going against kind of what I was talking about, that consistency in front of goal and scoring goals and this and that. I can see this one kind of being a little bit chippy. Just depending on how Pumas comes out. And like you said, Chris, if they are playing a little bit more physical and they are kind of kicking a little bit more, America might play a little bit more reserved. So we'll see. One thing I will tell you, though, it's going to be a late game, especially for you, Christian. It's 8 p.m. Pacific, 11 p.m. Eastern. Poor AJ, I'm going to have to.
I think 11:10, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, 11:10. And you know the game doesn't start at 11:10. It still takes like another 5-10 minutes to start. So it's like almost 11:30. I'm going to have to Uber Eats AJ some coffee or something, because he's just not going to make it through the whole night. But yeah, we'll see. We'll see what's going on. But yeah, 8 p.m. Just kind of round it out. 8 p.m. Pacific, 11 Eastern. Catch the game, guys, on To The End It. But make sure you guys follow us over on Twitter. We'll keep you guys up to date with everything going on. Again, should be a good one. Should be a fun one. Midwestern Cholo saying 4-1 to America, and Henry scores his 100th goal. I'm excited. Excited for when that actually does happen. And I guess Henry definitely merits it very much so. AP Jr. saying 2-1 for America. Hoping brawl breaks out. I don't know. AP Jr. is choosing violence for Saturday. But hey, it is America Pumas, so you never know. You absolutely never know. But he never said if the ball was in.
Those Suarez and Sendejas just start swinging at each other.
Just that. Yeah, I can see that happening. Absolutely seen that happening. But yeah, look, it's going to be an interesting one. Like I mentioned, we'll keep you guys up to date with everything going on in the world. Los Angeles del America. Kevin Perez saying, America 3, Las Gatas 0. A lot of confidence here that we're going to get upwards of 2, maybe even 3 goals. Midwestern Cholo going with the most crazy one when he said 4-1. But yeah, I think I think that does it for the predictions right here. Gentlemen, anything else you guys want to add on before we kind of wrap up the show here?
I wanted to touch on the question Christian was going to ask me about Sendejas playing on the left. It doesn't surprise me because he played in Necaxa on the left side. So it doesn't really surprise me that he's there. I think it's one of those things where he's more of an assister on the left because he plays with the left, right, with the left foot. Instead of shooting at goal, he's going to play more. And like Ivan brought up the fact that he has a better chemistry with Fidalgo on that left side, you notice that more. And like I said, like a while back, and I'm kind of hesitating in that thought, but to me, Sendejas is like a second engine in the team where you see him all over the place, similar to Fidalgo. So to see them eat off each other instead of having this unbalanced chemistry, it's really good to see.
1,000%.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, that does it for us today and this week. We'll be back next week, talk all things Club America and CONCACAF Champions Cup. Guys, it's squeaky bum time. The end of the season is coming up to an end, and a quick turnaround on all things, whether it's a league or CONCACAF Champions Cup. It's gonna be it's gonna be a doozy. I'll promise you guys that much. So get ready. Like I mentioned, make sure you guys follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and TikTok. We'll keep you guys up to date with all things Club America in English. Gentlemen, thank you so much for making the time talking all things Club America.
Of course, brother. Love talking about the greatest team to ever grace CONCACAF.
And the world.
The world, let's brother. Say it. That. Say it with me. The world.
And the world.
There we go. Absolutely. All right. Like I mentioned, we'll be back next week to talk CONCACAF Champions Cup. Until then, you guys have a wonderful time. Take care. And as always, Arriba en America. Good night.
Ladies and gentlemen, this was another production of the Eagle Eye Podcast, the number one source for all things Club America in English. Make sure to follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Eagle Eye Podcast and get all the latest news and coverage. And subscribe to our podcast.